Lord, we just pray right now, Father, for your Holy Spirit to come. Touch those that are hurting, Lord God, those going through tough times. Lord, we put our eyes on you. We know that, Lord, you are able, Father, to move mountains. Lord, we just know that you're our present help in times of trouble.
That you never changed. You stayed the same. That you are constant. That your love is near. That your presence is near, God. Lord, we yield to you, God, and ask, send your comforter, Lord. Send your comforter to be about your people, Lord, during this time. Lord, we want to feel your embrace, your presence, and that your glory would be our rear guard. Your glory would be our rear guard. Lord, we rest in your presence, and the government will be upon your shoulders, and your name will be called Mighty God, Prince of Peace. God, you are our Prince of Peace. Lord, we put peace about our shoes, God, that we can walk forward. Lord, I pray that every piece of the armor would be fully affixed so that we could stand strong, Lord. We could stand strong. With you living in us, greater is you living in us than he that is in the world, God. We love you, Lord.
Oh, Father, we love you. We need you, Lord. Would you send revival to your people? In this hour, in this desperate land, in this desperate time, Lord, we need more of you.
Yes, God.
We need an increase of your presence in our lives, Lord. We need an increase of your power. Oh God, we thirst for you. Oh God, we long for you. Oh God, we need you.
Yes.
And here, even in these moments, Lord, into your hands we commit these songs, these words, these chords, Lord, that you would use and that you would so animate and bring to life, bring to wholeness, bring to fullness people as a result of our service to you, Lord. We desire, Lord, that you would change us, that you would rearrange the priorities of our lives, that we would seek first the kingdom of God and your righteousness, and then allow you, Lord, to move in whatever way and in whatever direction you would choose. Let your spirit blow over this land, that you would bring revival to the hearts of your people. Lord, that you would bring up dry bones. And Lord, that you would bring life where there is no life. That you would bring peace where there is strife. Oh Lord, let us come and adore you. For you are greatly to be praised.
Father, we come before you today to seek your face, to do your will. We thank you that you are a covenant-keeping God that shows mercy to those that call upon you in truth. Your word never returns void, but it always accomplishes what you send it forth to. And we need that, Lord. Lord, even in your word, as we're given instruction, that your people that are called by your name, in every church, in every denomination that calls themselves by your name, Lord, that we would turn from our wicked ways, that we would seek your face
yes.
with all of our heart, that you would come and heal our land. And God, we need healing. We pray for your mercy, Lord. We pray for your loving kindness, that we would recognize your mighty hand, O God. Lord, that you would be glorified, that you would be lifted up in our government, that you would be lifted up in our schools, that you would be lifted up in our communities, that you would be lifted up in every branch of our government, Lord, that the name of Jesus Christ be exalted, that you would arise, Lord, and the enemy be scattered. In truth, O God, revive us, Father. Send your spirit upon our land again. Bring true revival, regenerating of hearts and minds. Forgive us of our complacency. Forgive us that we've been lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Forgive us, Father, that we've forsaken the way of truth in so many ways in our lives and in this country, God. Cleanse us of our unrighteousness, Lord. purge our iniquity, O God, by the blood of Jesus today, Father. Bring true revival to the families, marriages, O God, bring healing. Families, Lord God, bring healing. Our health, Lord, bring healing.
Yes.
Our mental health, Lord, bring healing. In every way, O God, as we look to you in your mercy and in your grace, Father. We pray for a revival in our land, O God. Purge the wickedness from among us, O God. Let not the wicked rule over us, but let the righteous be exalted. Those that hold to your word, those that hold to your truth, those that are unmovable, O God. We just thank you and we give you praise for your mercy toward us. Let it be extended, O God, that Christ would be lifted up again in our nation, O God, in our homes, in our families. O God, that we would love you and love your righteousness and love your truth. Have mercy, O God, and bring healing to our land, Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, even according to your word, O God, we thank you. Hallelujah, Lord.
Send revival down, send revival down, send revival down, down into this place. Send revival down, send revival down, send revival down, down into this place. Send it down, Lord, send it down, Lord, send it down, we need you, Lord. Send revival down, send revival down, down into this place.
The Lamb of Deliverance. The Lamb of Deliverance. We begin in Romans, the 7th chapter, verse 21. So I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members. What a wretched man I am! Who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Abel kept the flocks. Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, as they were established, Cain brought some of the first produce of his soil, and he offered it as an offering before the Almighty God. But Abel brought to his altar fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. Now the Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Genesis, the 4th chapter, verse 6. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must master it. Romans, the 7th chapter, verse 21. So I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. There is a law of wickedness, even as there is a law of righteousness. Both laws require certain conditions that must be met. The law of evil is embodied in a person. The law of righteousness is embodied in a person. And the person who chooses whether they will be under the law of evil or under the law of righteousness, that is a person also. This is all about people. This is not about some intellectual concept floating in the ether. This is about my personal decision about whether or not I will be under the law of evil or whether I will be under the law of life. And I must choose and act accordingly and meet the conditions for either side. There is no neutral territory. So God is speaking personally to Cain, and he is saying, it is crouching right at the door, and you must overcome it. There is not a culture of sin in the church called grace. That would confuse the two laws. We are either the law of evil or the law of righteousness. We cannot be under both laws. Either one will be in charge. We will be governed by the law. Now, you may quickly say to me, but Pastor, we're under the new covenant, and so we're not under the law. Well, wait a minute. What law are you speaking about? The New Testament refers to the law of righteousness and says we are under that law, the perfect law of liberty, the law that is under the direction and power of the Holy Spirit. There is no such thing as a free agent. Either it is the law of evil or it is the law of righteousness. Now, the law of righteousness sets us free. And so now here's Cain. Cain is in a very difficult position. His father sinned. His mother sinned against the Most High God, and they were kicked out of their home. And now all he can hear are the stories about what it was like when they lived in the garden. He can go with his dad, and I'm sure his dad took him by the hand and led him over to the east side of the garden and looked at the angel. Perhaps they even talked with that angel. Perhaps Cain said, "Can we ever go home, Daddy?" He knew he was not at home. But all right. We're now supposed to till the ground, and the ground is supposed to produce for us a harvest, even though there will be thorns and thistles, and the curse of God is on the ground. And now Cain has brought the very best that he could produce, and God did not receive it. I can't think of anything more crushing to a man's heart that when he produces the very best he has and brings it and presents it as a gift, to have that thing denied. I mean, surely you guys remember when you offered that girl the very finest you had and she turned up her nose and looked at you you're a throwaway, buddy. Yeah. Utterly crushing. I mean, it's still so embarrassing we don't even want to talk about it. I mean, of course, every young lady accepted every gift we brought. Are you kidding? You know, it's the young lady who chooses the man, not the man who chooses. We'd choose every beautiful young woman. But it gets sorted out when they start doing the choosing. I want you to see the steps that Cain begins to take now that caused him to walk into utter destruction. Genesis, the 4th chapter, verse 8. Now Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out to the field." And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and murdered him. I became curious as I was praying about this, and the Holy Spirit quickened in me. Why didn't Cain say, "Let's go out to the pasture"? Why did he say, "Let's go out to the field"? Because the field was his world. The field was where he was in charge. He would not humble his heart to ask his brother for a lamb. He would not even humble his heart enough to buy a lamb from his brother. So now he is faced with the question, will I allow this evil that is crouching at the door to take my life? And he says, "I will not offer a lamb." See, the only thing that could set him free was the lamb offering. The only way he could overcome the evil that was crouching at his door was to offer the lamb offering. He had no strength in himself to overcome the beast that was crouching at his door. He had no authority over that beast. Only the lamb had authority over that beast, and only the lamb could subdue it and subject it to failure in its attempt to take Cain's life. Begin to pray over this and say, "Lord, when temptation comes, are you saying my only defense is the lamb?" Well, you notice back here in Romans, the 7th chapter, it says, "What a wretched man I am." Surely that's the man who is facing the evil at the door, who has been mauled by it, who has no hope. Every bone is being broken by this wicked power. Everything is being destroyed, ripped apart. Who will rescue me from this body of death? In other words, I have no power to rescue myself. I've tried and I've failed. Thanks be to God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. I've always been troubled by that passage. I always wanted to rewrite it. I wanted it to say, "Thanks be to God, because Jesus Christ came riding on his horse to rescue me." Doesn't say that. It says, "Through Jesus Christ." It was the blood offering on Calvary that gave authority over the evil beast that was crouching at the door. It is through Jesus Christ, not by Jesus Christ. You understand what I'm trying to say? If we look at Jesus as our hero and say, "Jesus will save me," that's true. But how does he do it? Through Jesus, through the Lamb slain, through the cross of Calvary. God could not rescue us from the beast that was crouching at the door without dying on the cross. It's the cross that gave him the authority and the ability to break the power of that beast that crouched at the door for us. So Cain attacks his brother and he kills him. And the Lord says to Cain, "Where's your brother Abel?" "I don't know," he replied. "Am I my brother's keeper?" The beast crouching at the door has now leapt within his heart. In the beginning, it was simply crouching at the door, but now it dwells in him. Now it has taken bodily possession of him, so that now he's saying, "I am my own master, and everybody is on their own. I'm responsible for me and me alone. I'm going to do what I have to do to survive." Already now, the demon power has come in. It's running Cain. The Lord said, "What have you done?" I can't think of any more fearsome words to be spoken to my heart than for the Lord God of heaven to look at me and say, "What have you done?" That's the word that comes just before judgment. It's as though God, in all of his majesty and wisdom, cannot begin to understand how his creation could become so wicked and corrupt. He is astonished. God himself is astonished by the depth of the evil that has so quickly come into Cain. "Your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you're under a curse and driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand." So now he's told he can no longer make a living doing what he has wanted to do, which is simply till the soil. Let's look at it another way. He has now lost all significance. You take away from a man his ability to provide for the family, and you take away his significance. You take away his dignity. Because a man, by every standard, is to be the one who cares for his wife and cares for his children, provides. A man who cannot provide for his family, it's a man who's lost significance, dignity. He's now in shame. And now the first thing God says to him is, "I'm taking away from you your ability to do your job. You can't go to work anymore, Cain. You're fired." Have you ever been fired? I've never been fired, but I walked away. I fired my boss. Of course, I put it that way because it gave me more dignity than saying I was fired. Because the last thing I would want to admit is that I was fired. That's to strip me of my dignity. I at least have to have some shell of respect that says, I just didn't like how they were operating, so I fired them. Talk about denial. Was that pride? No. Verse 12, "When you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crop for you. You will be a restless wanderer on the earth." Oh, wait a minute. Now, not only has he lost his job, he just lost his house. He was just evicted. He can't go home again. So he's lost his job, and he's lost his housing. And Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is more than I can bear." How does a man lose his job, murder his brother, and then be evicted and be on the street? And where does he go then? And Cain says, "My punishment is more than I can bear. Today you're driving me from the land. I'll be hidden from you, from your presence." He's lost significance. He's lost his safe provision and place. He's lost his belonging, his home. He's now told, "Cain, you'll never have a home again the rest of your life. You're going to always be a wanderer. I'm never going to let you settle down again. That's the price for murdering your brother. Whoever finds me will kill me." But the Lord said to him, "No, not so. If anyone kills Cain, he will suffer vengeance seven times over." And then the Lord put a mark on Cain so that no one who found him would kill him. I wonder what the mark was. I wonder if God wrote on his chest, "Do not kill me." You know, now he is marked as a homeless man. I've been ministering to a homeless man, and I made the suggestion that he apply for a job at the Borders bookstore where he hangs. And he said, "Oh, I couldn't do that because then people would find out I'm homeless." I said, "Can you afford to be worried about whether people know you're homeless? Does your pride put food on your table? Does your pride get you out of sleeping in the car when it's 5 degrees above zero. He said, oh no, I have to have a place where I'm respected. I think that's how Cain felt. This thing of pride is so seductive and so wicked. It wants to reach up and create some illusion that I'm somebody. And so I'll take a title. I'll take a posture. I'll take a position. Just recognize I'm somebody of importance here. Pride does that. And Cain now, he doesn't know how to deal with the punishment of God on his life. The barrenness, the lack of a job and the lack of a home. And everywhere he turns, it's dark. It's cold. And so Cain, in verse 16, went out from the Lord's presence, and he lived in the land of Nod, east of Eden. The word Nod in the Hebrew means land of wandering. East of Eden, symbolically in the Hebrew language, means a place of new beginnings. So Cain now is a man who always must start over and always be a wanderer, never able to settle down and say, this is home. As soon as something begins to be established, it's ripped away from him, and he's a wanderer again, a new start, a beginner again. Have any of you ever gotten tired of starting over? Oh, how that has pierced my heart through the years. Always trying to start over. Not knowing that it was God who was saying, you must be a wanderer. Not willing to submit to what God was saying to my heart. I had to establish for myself my own place. A place of security, a place of respect, a place where I could be somebody. Where I could make a contribution, where I could help somebody. If I could just help somebody, that would give me a sense of my dignity. And God would take it away. Take it away. You notice the key here. The key is that in verse 16, he went out from the presence of the Lord. The Lord did not say he was driving him from his presence. Cain said, I'm leaving your presence. Still, the only place where Cain could have found a place of rest was in the presence of God with the offering of a lamb. That was his place. But he refused his place. His pride would not allow him to take the place that God offered to him. He would rather die than submit. Now the scripture continues with the story of Cain's descendants until finally we come to verse 23. Lamech lived probably 250 years after these events took place. 250, maybe even 300 years after these events took place. And now he's trying to create for himself a place of security by having more than one wife. He's not going to listen to the Lord God of heaven. If Adam needed one helpmate, he needs two helpmates. Ada and Zillah, listen to me. Wives of Lamech, hear my words. I have killed a man for wounding me, a young man for injuring me. If Cain is avenged 7 times, then Lamech 77 times. Lamech is saying, I will always kill and destroy whoever touches me. 77 times means my revenge is never fulfilled. I always will be out for more blood. This is 250 years later. These are the descendants of Cain. And this is their attitude. absolute bitterness of heart, destruction, raining it down on young men who would dare to interfere with their desires. And so you come then to Genesis, the sixth chapter, when men began to increase in number on the earth, and daughters were born to them. The sons of God saw that the daughters of men were beautiful, and they married any of them they chose. So now you have the watchers, the evil angels, who've been cast out of the presence of God, who still are visible on the earth, beginning to genetically intermarry with men so that the DNA of the human race can be destroyed, so that there can be no salvation for them. And the Lord said, "My spirit will not contend with man forever, for he is mortal. His days will be 120 years. Before this, his days were over 900 years. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days. The Nephilim being that mixture between human and evil spirit. When the sons of Godders went to the daughters of men and had children by them, they were the heroes of old, men of renown. So the men of renown on the earth were Nephilim men, Antichrist men, men who were utterly bitter against the Lord God of heaven. The Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart, only evil all the time. And the Lord was grieved that he'd made man on the earth, and his heart was filled with pain. So the Lord said, "I will wipe mankind whom I have created from the face of the earth, men and animals and creatures that move along the ground, the birds of the air, for I am grieved that I've made them." But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. A grandson of Seth found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Noah was a righteous man, blameless, and he walked with God. Romans, the seventh chapter. So I find this law at work in verse 21. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law. But I see another law at work in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members. What a wretched man I am! Who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I myself in my mind am a slave to God, to God's law, but in the sinful nature, a slave to the law of sin. This is the picture of the man or the woman who has not yet accepted Jesus Christ, who has not brought that lamb sacrifice before the Lord God of heaven. There are only two laws, the law of sin and death, and the law of righteousness. The law of sin and death ruled over Cain and all of his children until finally they were wiped off the face of the earth. They were destroyed. This was not a vote that the people of the earth could take. They did not have a campaign and decide whether or not the earth should be wiped clean with water. They didn't have any vote in the matter. It was decided by the Lord God of heaven. And then there is the law of righteousness. The law of righteousness was not established by us. It was established by the Lord God Almighty. It's not something we get to vote about. We're great on democracy. Heaven is not a democracy. The devil's camp is not a democracy, and heaven is not a democracy. We were cast into the enemy's camp by what Adam and Eve did in that garden. But there is the offer of the cross that we can accept and die with Jesus. Die to sin, die to this law of sin and death. We can die to all of our heart that desires to be a part of that kingdom of darkness. And through the blood offering at Calvary, we can be changed and transformed so that we no longer walk in sin. This is not a description in chapter 7 of the Christian. It's the description of the man who is not a Christian. Because we have been so confused by our culture, it's possible for us to begin to think that surely everybody could not be wrong. Surely the Washington Post must have some authority. Surely the New York Times should have some authority. Surely all of the wisdom of man should have some authority. But God is not impressed by the Washington Post. He's not impressed by NBC. The commentators can say whatever they wish to say, but God is going to have the last word, and His word will be righteousness. So we've come up with this neat little shell game that says the gospel of Jesus provides for a culture of sin covered by grace. That's what the popular world message is. But in the scriptures, you find only the law of sin and death or the law of righteousness. You find only those two. You find no middle ground. Jesus died to make me whole, to give me back a home, to give me back a work, to give me back a belonging. Everything that was stolen by the devil, the Lord intends now to give back in great abundance. Chapter 8. You recognize in the Greek there are no chapter divisions. The punctuation was not there. Notice the verse immediately following this. Chapter 8, verse 1. Therefore, as soon as you read that, you know everything that's going to be said has a direct reference to what was just said prior to the therefore. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. So my question to you today, have you been set free of the law of sin and death? Or is it still operating in your home, in your marriage, in your family? Have you been set free of this law of sin and death? Is there any condemnation left in your heart? All of this is based on whether or not you are in Christ Jesus. John, the 15th chapter, abiding in Christ, remaining in Christ. You see, we would like in our human spirit to say, okay, the law of righteousness is here. And now I'm free to go in the land of the law of righteousness. And I'm there to build whatever I'd like to build. I'm there to have a wonderful time. I'll tell you what my experience so far over here in the land of the Spirit of righteousness has been. On my inner being, it has been joy and peace and freedom. In my outer world, it has been suffering, deprivation, loss, not belonging, something strange and alien, so that people listen to the radio broadcast and they say, what kind of insane man would say those kinds of things? Who's he think he is to say that a man can live without sin? Everybody knows that you cannot live without sin. Everyone knows that who's in the land of sin and death. But as soon as you move over to the land of righteousness, you know you walk righteous before God. But you also know you're going to suffer persecution. You are not going to have the benefits of the land of sin and death. And listen, sin and death does have some benefits over here. You can work at a job and make great money and have a lifestyle. You can have great dignity. Over here, you can't have a job. The job belongs to Jesus. Over here, you can't have any money. The money belongs to Jesus. Here, you're not allowed to have your own life because your life belongs to Jesus. Are you catching it? Everything's in Jesus. There is no life outside of Jesus. The devil said, I'm going to have life outside of God. In fact, I'm going to get as high as God is. You watch what I can become. And so over here in the law of sin and death, one of the primary beliefs they hold is that there's something good in every man, and all we have to do is develop it and let it come forth and become all you can be. You have wonderful potential. The law of sin and death says that, but over here the law of righteousness says you don't have any potential. Jesus has all the potential. You don't have any self-esteem over here. You only esteem Jesus Christ. So you walk in humble obedience to the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, and what is your benefit? Peace and joy and love. Knowing that everything is in the hand of Jesus. Knowing that He will carry you in His arms. That He'll comfort you in all persecutions and trials. I choose the land of life. Have you made that choice? Are you a brother to Cain? Or are you a brother to Seth? Almighty God, I ask that we as a fellowship would live in you, that by the blood shed on Calvary's tree, we would be washed clean, and that we would live righteous and holy lives with love pouring from our hearts, with no bitterness, no anger, no pride, no establishing myself as somebody, but humbly submitting to you, Jesus, the King of all the earth. Lord, I pray that not one of us would puff ourselves up and pretend to be something, but a humble servant of the Most High God. Lord, today would you make it plain in our hearts where we are. Today you're still saying the same thing. Sin is crouching at the door. You must overcome it. Thank you, Jesus. I receive today the Lamb of God, slain from the foundation of the earth. And I offer him as my only plea. And all of God's people said, Amen, Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us. You've been listening to Pilgrim's Progress, brought to you by the National Prayer Chapel. We're a house church located in Woodbridge, Virginia. Our mailing address is Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. Come visit us at nationalprayerchapel.com. God bless you. We love you.